fights, Dave Video Warriors, and yeah, probably one of the quickest I've ever suggested a commentary and then actually recorded it. I think it was like on Monday I put on the forum, I put, which would people rather see a commentary for, either the 2004 Alamo or the 1997 Saint, and Welsh Film Buff and Terry posted, thanks very much by the way guys, that they'd quote unquote like to hear me defend the Saint. And so, but I can't believe that it's one of the quickest the commentary's been done. That said, I can't believe that it took this long for either me or me and somebody else to do a commentary for this movie, because it's one of those films where I've lost count how many times I've either seen this film or talked about it in some way, or I've just referenced it in some fashion. So yeah, on the one hand, I'd like to think I've done this, you know, commentary, you know, in a short space of time, but that said, I mean, I had to, you know, check Zarbin's site the other day to something. Haven't we already done this? You know, actually, I might just check it right now just to make I'm not sure I'm going insane, because it's like one of those films where, oh, anybody hasn't done this, even if it's just somebody really ripping the piss out of it, is amazing to me. Like I say, I'm just on Zarbin's page now. I'll just check. Nah, nothing's come up the Saint. Weirdly, a load of episodes of Doctor Who have come up, Pals of St. John. Anyway, yeah, so we're doing 1997's The Saint, and this is one of those films where, like, I always used to like when, well, still do, like, RoboCop's coming out in a few days, and I like it when new versions of older films come out, or especially older TV shows like The Saint, or Doctor Who, funnily enough. And it's really funny, because this film has almost made me kind of changed my viewpoint a little tiny bit, but not for me personally, just generally. But when this film came out, I was really looking forward to this film. I thought, oh, great, new version of Saint. Grew up watching The Saint. I was a fan of the Ian Ogilvy version of The Saint, Return of the Saint. Loved it, thought it was brilliant, loved the theme tune, loved the car, loved just the general concept of the programme and everything. And I know my dad used to like the Roger Moore Saints. We used to watch the Roger Moore Saint and things like that. And then there was the Simon Dutton Saint that was on for a little bit. I think it was in the mid-90s. So I've always kind of liked when this character came back. You know, I was associated with TV, even though I later became more familiar with or more aware of movie versions of this film. Sorry, of this property. But when this film came out, I thought, oh, great, new version of the Saint. I thought, I'll be able to watch it with my dad, I'll be able to watch it, and, you know, people, you know, you might, you know, spawn a new TV series or sequels and things like that. But when this film came out, like, I watched it at the cinema, and I really enjoyed it. And when it came on video, I showed it to my dad, and my dad was just like, eh, like, I think he even fell asleep halfway through it. And just generally, like, you know, oh, one thing, just while his name's on screen, Robert S. Barker, or Baker even, so I pronounced his name wrong. But I didn't realise that he has been involved with every version of The Saint up until this point. Oh, sorry, every version of The Saint from Roger Moore, Ian Ogilvy, I think Simon Dutton, and this version. So I was kind of surprised to sort of, when I sort of realised his name was sort of, like, sort of on, like, I was like, oh my god, that's, where's that name so familiar? Oh yeah, it's been in, like, you know, 5 decades worth of The Saint. Oh, just 2 seconds. Well, everybody, just cat wanted to leave the room. I didn't realise I'd shut the door. Yeah, so anyway, yeah, I was surprised to see Robert Baker's name there, and some of its names to surprise to see on screen. Joseph Niemack III. And he's one of those guys that, you know, a name that you don't normally recognise necessarily. And you'd be watching, like, Commando or something, or I think, like, Escape from LA, and it's like, oh wow, there's that guy. Oh, that guy. That's really, because really, I haven't watched this film properly for a while. I've noticed Wesley Strict wrote this, and I think he was involved with the Elm Street remake. He's the remake spin-off guy. So when lost my train of thought a little bit, but yeah, so when this film came out, I thought, oh yeah, great new version of the Saint. And then, like I say, something like my dad, who was like a reference point for the Saint in like Bond and things like that, my dad was like, nah. And then I think the people who lived across the road, I lent it to them on video, and they enjoyed it, and they sort of said, oh, you know, they thought it was pretty cool. But then just generally on the internet, and you know, people slant, you can't use the internet as necessarily, you know, the gospel kind of thing, you know, pun intended. There's been like a quasi-religious movie, but like people on the internet slagging it off, and I think it, you know, did okay business. But I think most of the major people involved, like Phillip, Noyce and Val Kilmer, were signed on to multiple pictures and possible sequels, but because it didn't do that good and it got slagged off, or it did middling as far as I remember, no sequel. And then, but this is the kind of thing what made me sort of almost, and especially something that happened within the last couple of months, made me almost completely change our view, sort of modern interpretations of things, because I was really hoping that this would sort of make the Saint sort of come back, and sort of, even though I wouldn't class myself as a hardcore Saint fan, I definitely like the concept, and I like, you know, the little stick man drawing, the fact he's got a cool car, and you know, he's like saves the day and gets the girl and all that kind of stuff. So it's always one of those things, always on the periphery, is that a word? But I always kind of liked when this character came back, and there's been a newer version of the Saint, what a pilot made, and my mind's just temporarily gone blank, so I'll just check who was in it. The Saint 2013 or 2014. TV pilot. Adam Rayner is in the new Saint, with, weirdly, Roger Moore and Ian Ogilvy. But it was one of those things where that didn't get picked up for a pilot. It didn't get picked up for a series, and again, I felt like I had my fingers burnt twice, because I was hoping this would do well, and then when I found out about this new Saint, I was like, oh great, they're trying again, there's going to be a new Saint, awesome. And then it was like, people were like, bitching and moaning as they always do on the net, and then it didn't get picked up, and it kind of almost, like, to me, it's like almost like some kind of karma, in the sense that, like, these things that really should be shoo-ins, really. I mean, should at least be a TV series. I mean, I know it's expensive, you know, having like a cool car and, you know, expensive suits and action scenes and things like that. But I always thought the Saint would be one of those things that would just, I mean, I guess technically it is running because it's been going forever, but I mean, one of those things where I just kind of, you know, assumed that, you know, it would do a lot better. But what sort of, like I say, but because people bitched and moaned about this Val Kilmer one, and people bitched and moaned about this pilot, it kind of almost made me think, well, maybe they shouldn't even try to make new versions of the Saint, or even Bond to a point, or because, well, at least with newer properties, that the fans are quite, you know, loyal, for want of a better word, even though the properties are newer. But you look at some new series, I'd say the Harry Potter films, or say even say Twilight, I haven't seen those films, or the Saw movies and things like that, or Fast and the Furious, not really films I'm super familiar with, but at least their fans at least sort of, you know, stick with him, and maybe 20, 30 years from now, they shouldn't bother making new Harry Potter, or they shouldn't bother making new Fast and the Furious movies, because all the fans are going to do is just bitch and moan, and go, oh, it's not as it was as good as it was in my day, or you know, and things like that, or, oh, not as good as, you know, Daniel Radcliffe as Harry Potter, or not as good as Vin Diesel in Fast and the Furious and something. So, and it's a bit like this new RoboCop film that's coming out, even though I'm really, really looking forward to it, I can't help thinking, well, why bother making a RoboCop movie? You know, all people, I mean, I'm interested in it. I love the property, I love the character, I love the concept. But if people are just going to be like, you know, it's like, well, you know, I don't know, kind of rambling. But anyway, kind of completely talked over the first, how long have we been recording for? First 10 minutes, maybe? Nearly exactly 10 minutes. For the first 9.5 minutes of the movie. But to play devil's advocate, I'm going to just have a sip of my drink, sorry. Um, not too bad. If I was going to play devil's advocate, though, I can kind of see that first little bit of the sort of quote-unquote origin story. I can understand if you're a hardcore fan of the character. I can understand maybe that was a little bit annoying, because as far as I know, that's just been sort of tacked onto the movie. That's never, it was never a thing that was in the books, and I don't think it's really been in any of the other films or anything like that. The couple of Saint movies I've seen, I think one with Hugh Sinclair and called Saint Vacation, and I think there's like been sort of, I think maybe probably as a kid I saw maybe like there was I think there's an Ian Ogilvy sort of cobbled together movie of two episodes, and maybe I saw that. So I don't think it's an element that has been in any of the other movies. So I can understand if you're a hardcore Saint fan that being like, oh, that's a little bit lame, because like even I've got to admit that like again Wesley Strickland, that's something about newer remakes and newer interpretations of characters. They always tell you what was going on, and oh, this is their motivation. And that's one thing I did think was kind of cool about the Saint. And funnily enough, it's weird that Dr. Drew coming up in that search on Sorbonne's page. But the one thing I do quite like about the Saint, like I say, and even counting this movie, is basically the origin is almost such an afterthought. It literally, when I sort of think of the Saint, I literally think of just a guy driving around in a cool car, and that's basically it. And he just arrives at some location, and you know, there's some weird scheme going on by some bad guy, and he has to stop it. I never think of, oh, like Batman is getting revenge, or you know, it's like Death Wish. He's like, you know, he's like, he's sort of, because all his family's been murdered and stuff like that. I kind of liked that about the Saints, was it was just like, yeah, he's just a bloke doing stuff and that. You know, I just kind of liked the throwaway nature of such a great character. The way he's got, like, you know, he's in his own logo, his oh, 2 seconds, it's a cat again. Wait for a sandwich for a buzz, and I don't care if I do that, I come to four, I do it twice in 10 minutes. I can't lose my train of thought, please. Alzheimer's. Yeah, but it's like, to me this is almost like, if you could split this movie up into like 25 minute parts, it would almost be, to me, sort of a great sort of like little TV show. The fact that, like, you know, a great TV series, like it used to be, like, you know, it's just him on an adventure, you know. Like, now to me it's like, if you took away that little origin story at the start of this, it's like, oh, what's he doing, you know, he's like, he's breaking into somewhere, and you know, there's a bad guy finding him, a bit like, you know, the start of like the Indiana Jones movies, excuse me. And another great example that, like, when that indie movie came, was coming out, I was like, oh, that's great, there's been another Indiana Jones movie. Great, we can, you know, I think, you know, like more recently I've heard it, you know, people say that, like, you know, like they sort of like seeing these characters again, and that is so cool. That, like, you know, to me that is like such an awesome thing, that, you know, it is spending time with this character again. And it, and Val Kilmer's interpretation of the Saint might be different than, say, Roger Moore's or Ian Ogilvy's, but to me it's being with that character, you know. And that's like, that's sort of why I think I enjoy this movie so much. And I know, like I say, it's almost become such a cliche now for me to be sticking up for the underdogs, but it is with this movie that, like, well, I don't know why people hate this film so much, or people, like, I can understand you people being like kind of almost indifferent to it, but like, I've heard people like really like, oh, the Saint and all, you know, Val Kilmer's a load of shit and all this, and it's like, well, it's just a nice action movie, you know. It's like, I don't know, you know, this film, like I say, you know, I've got the DVD literally sitting right next to me now, but, you know, with it being Video Warriors, I thought, oh well, I'll use the one I taped off TV, you know. It adds to the charm that watching like a really bastardised 4:3 version of it, and it's like, you know, you've got some sparklies on there. I did try to do a little test at first of even getting the BBC announcer just sort of saying, up next, Val Kilmer is the Saint, you know, and all this, but it didn't kind of record very well, so I kind of scratched the idea. But talking about that though, it's recorded off tape. I'll have to take a picture of it, and I might even have it as the title screen for a little while on Video Warriors, but I'll definitely have to start a thread and put a lot of these images. I know I sometimes get things to talk about, like when I'm sort of watching the film and stuff like that. But one thing that always makes me laugh when I see this, because I say I've got a soft spot for this movie, and like I say, I don't really see there's a great deal wrong with it in terms of just a good action movie. It's just good adventure movie, especially. I mean, it's just a great adventure movie, just a perfect, absolutely perfect, either drinking movie or watching it just when you're recovering from an hangover movie, bank holiday movie. I think it works brilliantly for both. But the thing what kind of makes me smile about this is I got this idea from somebody at college. Like I say, I have this version of it, I've got taped off here. Oh, that's not with the Saints. Maybe come to that in a bit, but the Saint music, because that's another thing. And again, I know occasionally I will do something just, at country, not for the sake of it, but I hate being pigeonholed and I hate being told what to do. So it's like, people say, oh, you will like this amazing movie, and I completely go the opposite way and think, well, I won't watch it for 10 years, and it's cut me nose or smack my face. But like the Saint theme, like the da-da-da-da-da-da, like that, even though that is the Saint music and I was associated that with the Saint, but because I grew up watching The Return of the Saint with Ian Ogilvy, that's got a different tune. So to me, like, because he was my Saint, that I sort of think of that is the Saint music, and this is almost some almost like the theme to Star Trek: The Next Generation, or the Star Trek a Star Wars spin-off like Droids or something. Like, to me, the Return of the Saint theme is the proper theme, and the proper theme is almost like a different version of it. So it's kind of funny. It's like I have to almost like second guess myself when I hear that Saint music, because it's like, what is that? Oh yeah, it's the Saint in Moscow here, Red Square, somewhere I'd love to go. Watched Firefox too many times and ready. But anyway, rambling. But what always makes me laugh about this, like I say, it's a taped off TV version, which was really endearing to me. But I got this idea from somebody at college. When they taped someone off TV, they were caught from the listings in the paper, or like the TV Times or the Radio Times, and stick it onto the tape so that they would, so they could easily just pull it off the shelf, or just, see what review it got in the paper. But for some reason, I did that for this film, and I cut out the paper, I think it was out the Sentinel, which is the local Staffordshire newspaper where I'm from, and it says, tonight's best film, Val Kilmer stars in The Thriller, The Saint, BBC One, 10:35, and it's got The Saint, a 3-star review, BBC One. But even though I really like this movie, I can't help but thinking, if this was the best film on TV, because it's obviously a 90s movie, so at this point in time, there would have been, at least 10, 15 movie channels. There would have been films on BBC One, films on, there would have been like multiple ways of watching movies, and things like that. So I always thought it always makes me laugh when I see this tape. On this day, according to somebody, it was tonight's best film on TV. So it's a little something that it's kind of like, that's just funny to me. But another thing as well, though, I wish I hadn't cut the date off of when this was broadcast, because I could really, zero in on when I actually watched this movie. But one thing that is quite cool, and I don't know where I got this idea from, again, it might have been from somebody at college, but if I've ever been to see a film at the cinema, I don't do it as much now, because I'm not as kind of anally retentive as I used to be, but I used to like putting the actual cinema ticket from a film in the DVD box. When the film came on DVD, I would sort out my ticket from when I went to see it at the cinema and put it in the box, so I could say, I went to see that in the cinema, or how much did it cost, or when did I go see it, and all those kind of things. But these tickets, and again, I'll have to take a picture of this, because I know people probably aren't as geeky as me, but like, I really loved that these old-fashioned Onion cinema tickets, they were like, almost like bus tickets, for want of a better phrase. But they just give you so much information of when you went to see a film. Like now, like the little tiny, receipts at the View, and they're still on card occasionally at the Odeon. But like when I went to see Grudge Match the other day, I had to go to the concessions counter because it was early in the morning. The box office wasn't open because, as we all know, opening a box office in a cinema would be a right pain. And then it came out as like a crappy till receipt, which is kind of cool, I guess. I mean, in the sense that it's a sign of the times, you know, cinemas were at that point in time. But these old Odeon cinema tickets are great. Like, obviously, I mentioned this one because we're watching The Saint, but so in my DVD box, The Saint, on my Odeon cinema ticket here, it's Odeon Screen 2, Row G, Seat 7, which that cinema is still there, and it hasn't really been. They've had a few premier seats, so maybe that seat might have gone, but the cinema's still there, or touch wood, the screen's still there, and I could go and even to sit on the same row in the same seat if I, you know, was so inclined to. I'd have to go see a film on that screen. Anyway, that's beside the point. I went to see it on the 19th of the 4th, 97. It's January, February, March, April, so saw it on the 19th of April, 1997. It says the day was a Saturday. I saw it at 17.20, and the price was £3.60. It seemed like the full title says The Saint, not like some weird acronym or just Saint or something. I just think that's so great that that's such like a sort of snapshot of that's where I was at that point in time, and that's exactly what I was doing. And I just think that's like, you know, such a great thing that, like, you know, it's sort of like, now like I say, you know, cinema tickets now, they are kind of cool, but you know, and even they used to have adverts on the back as well. I can remember, but just before Dick Tracy came out, they'd have like, "I'm on my way," and seen that for months on end. Oh my god, Dick Tracy's coming out. So, obviously, that's kind of cool. It's like, I'll try, you know, I've got another couple of little collectibles, but I'll try, you know, talk about them as, you know, get through the movie and stuff. But yeah, so this is one thing as well. I've got to admit that this. If you were a hardcore or an older Saint fan, I can imagine this kind of stuff rubbing up the wrong way. These, like, the way they've got computer programs and they send sort of passwords to people, because it's such, you know, it's such BS that, you know, that, like, you know, computers don't work like this, or, you know, it's just like, I guess it's a kind of interesting way to get computery stuff at least somewhat cinematic and somewhat interesting to anybody who's not a complete geek. But that element like that, where even though I'd just go, oh yeah, it's like a MacGuffin, and you know, they just use these computers with these crazy, like, you know, crazy passwords and crazy sort of way of speaking, and everything has to be translated and decoded and things, I'm just like, just take it for granted kind of thing. But I imagine if you were a fan of the older Saints or the novels, that this would be, you know, be a bit of a pain. But one thing a lot of people always like this film as for is the disguises and the sort of the different characters that he plays. But again, to me though, that's like one of the things. Well, why not do a little different? Why not play it slightly differently? And like say, when I watch older episodes of The Saint, like say, especially like the Roger Moore Saint, there was like, you know, 70 episodes, whatever the old one was, and I think it was like 12 episodes of the Ian Ogilvy one, and there was 6 of the Simon Dutton one, and things like that. But any time I watched The Saint, and I was just fluke or just circumstance, but some of them really mental, like, you'll have like a guy who's pretending to be an old woman so he can bump off his wife or something. And I'm going to check this now, because I always feel like I've imagined this, but I'm sure there's a Roger Moore episode of The Saint where he fights a giant spider. Just 2 seconds, Saint. Giant spider. Sorry, I'm just having a drink. That's what it sounds like through a mic. Well, I should know, because I usually... It's coffee, by the way, it's not booze, unfortunately for me. And that's something else. Roger Moore saying... I'm sure there was an episode of The Saints with it, like say, with a spider in it. And if there was, say, I may have just imagined it. uh-huh. Excuse me. So anyway, if I haven't just imagined it, 118 episodes of the Roger Moore Saint, according to Wikipedia. But I'm sure I read somewhere that there was one where he fights a giant spider, unless the con is what the hell I'm thinking of, if it's not right. But anyway, I've seen some really crazy episodes of the Saints with, like, really dodgy, and again, I hate saying this because it's such the obvious, like, you know, ooh, old TV a bit shit, but, like, you know, really sort of hammy, sort of, you know, they'll be talking on the phone and just put the phone down in really random places and it looks hilarious, it looks like something from Mystery Science Theatre, or really obvious stunt doubles, like I bought a Saint VHS, you know, Ogilvy Saint, where he was like fighting a bull or something, or there was this woman fighting this bull and you could tell a mile off that it wasn't the right person, and things like that, and there's just some episodes where you're just like, what's happening here? And I think that's the thing, and that's why I think I'm surprised people didn't give this more of a pass, really, because when I watch old episodes of The Saints, as enjoyable as they are, some of them are pretty stupid, you know, and don't get me wrong, I'm not, you know, as anybody who's listened to more than two of these commentaries, I'm not a huge reader, so I've never read any of the hundreds of books that there is, and I don't know if the character's that much different in the books, but people, like, you know, the Inspector Teal character in this, people saying, oh, it's not the same as, you know, in the books and things, well, in the TV show, and it must just be how my brain works, but I literally, for the most part, apart from when he's doing the really crazy impersonations and the really pushing the limit stuff of this movie, excuse me, to me it's just The Saint. I've seen some pretty wacky episodes of The Saint over the years. I don't see what the difference is. Excuse me. What's funny about this though? This is one thing that I do remember about this movie, which just come up, Oxford, England. And one thing I do the distinct about this movie is I remember seeing pictures in The Sun, I think it was, and saying, oh, they're filming in Oxford. And again, it's that classic, let's have a little crafty dig at this movie, because they showed in a picture of Val Kilmer with long hair, and they were like, oh, isn't he dead different than the Roger Moore Saint? When they didn't, you know, they didn't say, oh, no, it's one of the disguises he was wearing and stuff like that. And I read a great quote from Phillip, Noyce. It's the one little collectible thing that I haven't pulled out in all the stuff I've pulled out today. Is that I remember Phillip Noyce saying that it was easier to film in Moscow than it was to film in Oxford, and I thought that says kind of a lot about the British film industry and why the British film industry is struggling. But I thought you can see a shot of the car, but that was another cool thing about this movie was the car, but I'll probably get to that as the sort of car parts come on. There's another great thing about this movie as well, though, is Elisabeth Shue in this movie is smoking hot, and, you know, again, one of those things where I know it's pretty sort of shallow, and you know, but like, if you're gonna have a action adventure slash you know, thriller movie, and you're gonna have like hot, attractive woman as the counterpart, again, I don't see how that's I don't see what how could that could possibly be a bad thing, you know. Oh, that's one thing though, spoilers, but it doesn't really, because this version doesn't really exist, but apparently in the original cut she dies, Elizabeth Shue's character, I think Simon Russell, and it shows how much I've seen this movie, because if that is a name, I'm rubbish at remembering names, so that'd be funny if that is the character's name. But yeah, she dies. And that's another thing about this film. It had reshoots, and they tinkered with it a little bit. And it's that thing again where, like, geez, because of, you know, this, because it was having this history, and people wanting it being like the old Saint, and then the bits they do change, people moan about, and then when they try and make it a film that's like added interesting, sort of an interesting twist to the, you know, the romantic lead dying, people bitch to moan about that, so it becomes just more generic again, and it's just like, geez, I mean, don't get me wrong, I give this film a big, you know, I cut it a lot of slack kind of thing, but at the same time, it's like, oh god, it could have been so much better if people, you know, so many people went interfering and just, oh, I want it like this, I want it like that, I want it like this, and I'm really surprised though, actually, the elements of this that they did carry over, like the original Saint music, or the, you know, the main melody, the little Saint stick man, the fact that he drives a Volvo, I mean, the only two, I mean, even though I really like the really boxy old estate sort of really clunky looking, you know, old-fashioned Volvos, and I think there's something really cool about the other scenes, these really boxy Volvos that you can put like loads of crap in there and stuff like that. I do kind of like the fact that the only really two cool Volvos I've ever seen were in the Roger Moore Saint and this, and I think there's just something, you know, again, you know, what action star nowadays has got the flat out balls to drive a Volvo? I mean, I thought that was such a nice little nod to the original Saints, and it's all product placement and it's all money at the end of the day, and you know, it's all like, you know, movie bullshit, but I thought, like, you know, can you imagine, you know, Bond rolling up in a Volvo, or, you know, or Jason Bourne or something? It's like, the Saint drives a Volvo still. I mean, that's pretty awesome to me. I know the cars have changed over the years, like, you know, the amazing Jaguar XJS in Return of the Saint, and I think Simon Dutton drove a Jensen Interceptor. But, yeah, to me it was kind of cool. What is kind of funny, though, as well, like I say, over the years, like, any time I see something to do with this Val Kilmer Saint, I say it's really interesting because, and I think I've said this on my Firefox commentary, but, like, I mean, I think most movie fans' top 10 favourite movies change over the years. It's kind of like, you know, like my sort of, especially my top 5 favourite movies change almost like on a weekly basis, and like, you know, a spot from like, so maybe In the Mad, The Madness, Clockwork Orange, and the real, you know, the real, oh my god, they're my favourite movies. But I've got like a top 10 movies that I think are amazing, like say In the Mouth of Madness and things like that, and then I've got like a top 10 favourite movies, you know, things like I don't know, say Daredevil or something like that, or Firefox or something, and but this is a weird film because it kind of almost falls in between those two things, where if somebody said to me, oh, you know, like films that I watch a load, like, you know, this might not necessarily be in there, but if I ever see this is on TV, or if I ever see something on eBay, more often than not I will get it, if, especially if it's, you know, just a couple of quid or whatever. And one thing that, again, I could put a picture of this on the forum for anybody who's interested, is I got these three Saint postcards, and they were like released in promotion with Volvo, and there's a couple of the car, which is this Volvo C70, and one of Val Kilmer. But it's like, it's just one of those things, like, now, like, any, again, when I see this stuff, it's like, oh my god, I brought Volvo postcards. Like, and but again, though, it's this thing of like, I would have loved just being in a Volvo dealer at the time when this film was brand new, and just, you know, going, oh wow, you know, must be, because Volvo, every so often, though, they will kind of take chances like this, because, which seems a weird thing to say about Volvo, because I think when Pirates of the Caribbean came out, there was some kind of weird promotion where, I don't know, they were like buried a Volvo somewhere, or there was some kind of like treasure hunt thing, and you know, you could win a Volvo. And I remember going up to the local Volvo dealer just for, see if I could see this car, and I don't think it was there at the time, but I wish I'd gone up there when this film was new, see if there was any of these Saint Volvos in there. I mean, obviously it wouldn't have been the one from the film, but it would have been cool to see a similar kind of car. One thing I do quite like about it, and again, it's something that I think pissed off the purists, and again, it kind of makes sense, like I can see, but the way Roger Moore's Volvo was white, the way Ian Ogilvy's car was white, I kind of love it, this car's bright red. It's kind of like, you know, as much as it is like a little nod to the original, like, oh yeah, he's driving a Volvo, it's the complete polar opposite colour. I mean, at least it wasn't like, you know, I know, silver, or, you know, at least it wasn't like some kind of like metallic black for, like, you know, try cashing on, like, you know, Batman or something. You know, it was kind of like, at least he did actually put some crazy ass bright colour in there. I thought that was kind of cool. Again, yeah, talking about the Saint music, though, as well, like the main Saint melody. One thing about this film, and again, I think I said this on one of the other soundtracks, and it was one of the soundtracks, one of the commentaries, and nobody knew what the hell I was on about. But to me, there's two kinds of soundtrack. You've got, like, you know, if you said to, you know, a quote-unquote normal person, name the top 20 movie soundtracks or movie scores of all time, you know, probably rightfully so, they would mention things like, you know, things like The Omen, Planet of the Apes, Star Wars, Jaws, you know, these really sort of iconic, you know, amazing, you know, soundtrack albums, you know, that, like, really sort of, you know, iconic all around the world. But to me, and again, I know I'm drawn to sort of the kind of stupider end of cinema, or the films that get slagged off, but if you said to me, pick your top 10 favourite soundtrack albums, it would be the original Karate Kid, Halloween 5, and you know, real random, like, you know, soundtracks I used to play when I used to play on the computer, or, you know, say, driving around in a car or something, just whack a tape in, or on my MP3 player or something. And the soundtrack to The Saint is one of those soundtracks where, and it's a real proper, and not just by my crazy ass standards in music, and this is really sort of quote unquote cool soundtrack. It's got bands like Orbital on there, Moby, the Chemical Brothers, Underworld, Daft Punk, David Bowie, Everything But the Girl, and it's like a genuinely good soundtrack. And I think it's just one of those soundtracks, I think, for the most part, you know, it's one of those soundtracks a bit like the Tron, you know, almost like an offshoot of the Tron Legacy soundtrack, where you won't hear a bad word say, you know, if you're a fan of dance music or if you're a fan of that genre of music, you won't hear a bad word said about it. And it's like, but like the Saint soundtrack, maybe one of those soundtracks, you know, 20, 30 years from now, it will be like, oh yeah, that was a great soundtrack, and still, you know, even now it's still old water now, because I don't think they pandered to the masses, and, you know, they didn't have some, like, you know, in the Orbital, who did, you know, their version of the Saint music, which, weirdly, they did a version of the Doctor Who music as well. God, these two things are kind of connected. But yeah, so they went for a band like Orbital, which were cool, but it wasn't like, you know, they weren't like, oh, super fashionable, or they weren't like, you know, on all the, you know, they weren't on all the TV shows at the time, you know, or they weren't like, you know, number one in the charts or something. You know, they were like a cool band, but I liked how, you know, they went for that kind of, that thing. This is a scene I always liked about this film. The scene where they're in the pub. I don't know it again, just because I'm alcoholic or borderline, but there's something about when you see like a really traditional English pub, especially like in a Hollywood movie. Because I think this is, again, I think this is something where, you know, they kind of got right. I mean, you know, for all, you know, the things that I think people probably thought, oh, you know, his stupid accents, which I thought were kind of cool, or the stupid disguises he wore, you know, I think, you know, considering this was made by, I don't think none of the people involved in it were English, you know, to get, like an English pub looking like, kind of like an English country pub, it kind of works. I mean, you know, it's like, you don't see many British movies where the pubs look this realistic, apart from maybe like Shaun of the Dead or Hot Fuzz or something. Oh yeah, one thing, talking about books. Well, so I'm just, like I said, I haven't really read the novels. And this one, the few novelizations that wasn't written by, this is one of the few Saint novels that was written by somebody apart from the main guy, Leslie Charteris, which I'm sure I'm pronouncing that name wrong, which is terrible if I am. But there was one Saint book, Saint from Screen to Small. Sorry, I'm just tricking it loud. Oh, here we go. Yeah, there's a book here that I really wouldn't mind to have another look at this book, because I rented this book years ago from the library. I had it for months and years. I think I had it. I think I got my A level film studies book from the library, and I got this book at the same time. I had them for about 6 years before I took it back, so I don't think I really need to look at it again. But I can't help thinking I'm kind of maybe read into something, no pun intended, to something that wasn't really there. But there's this book called The Saint, From Big Screen to Small Screen and Back Again. It's on Amazon, and it is by, who is it by? Paul Simper, I think his name is. Yeah, it is, yeah. Oh yeah, by Paul Simper. So The Saint, From Big Screen to Small Screen and Back Again. And I had this book for a long, long time. And it was one of those books where, again, what's probably just put me on this course of sort of hoping almost that they never do another version of The Saint, because it's like, well, I like all these different versions of The Saint, but all these old fans, you know, well, they may as well just stick watching the, you know, the same videos over and over and over again, because, well, you know, they just don't like any of the new ones. And this book really encapsulated that to me, because, again, like I say, you know, given the benefit of doubt, and I don't really, you know, even though it's just my personal opinion, and, you know, I don't really like slagging stuff off, But even though, as much as I really enjoyed this book, and it was really funny, it had some really, you know, good information in, and it talked about another pilot that was made in the 80s where the saint like had a mustache and drove a Lamborghini around and stuff, and it's told me all this information that I didn't know about the previous saint movies, and, you know, the history of the saint, and, you know, all these different things. One thing about this book that really did my head in was that anybody who wasn't Roger Moore was considered crap. It was like, oh, don't like this saint, oh, not as good as Roger Moore, ain't Roger Moore brilliant? And as much as I like Roger Moore cameos in this, by the way, even though I like Roger Moore, it was like this book was so tiring, just in the sense of every page it was like, oh, not as good as Roger Moore. What, Roger Moore brilliant? Oh yeah, Roger Moore, oh, I like Roger Moore. Oh, and I was like, oh my god. And then there was one thing that really sticks out in my mind about this book, and again it shows sort of the negativity of, like, you know, when people are fans of a series, and again I guess it's kind of sweet really in a lot of ways, but it was like, the 1996, I'm paraphrasing, but basically words this effect, and again I'm pretty sure I'm not far off the mark, you said, this film was cursed at the minute Val Kilmer was cast. And I was like, well, that's a little bit harsh. I mean, when you think, like, you know most people like Top Gun. I'm not a huge fan of Top Gun, but I think it's okay. I think it's brilliant in Batman Forever, and it was a successful Batman movie. You know, it was one of those things where, you know, people can slag that film off all they want. Now, Batman Forever was a successful movie. You know, Willow was successful. It seemed like, well, you know, a lot of women seemed fancy him. He seemed like, you know, well, you know, he's got that kind of look, that movie star look about him. Why couldn't he have been this film might have been a misstep for a lot of people, but why just the fact that Val Kilmer was cast as a saint surely is not enough to make this thing, you know. When I heard Val Kilmer was the saint, I was like, okay, Val Kilmer's the saint. I mean, like I say, as much as, you know, probably one of my favourite Batman interpretations of Batman, also Bob Kane's favourite interpretation of Batman, as far as I'm aware, that's like, you know, it's not one of those things, well, you know, I don't see why just Val Kilmer being cast as the saint was any worse than, you know, all these other people who've played him. And like I say, you watch something like, I watched The Saints Vacation a couple of weeks ago with my dad, that's just as, you know, just as good or bad as this, depending on, you know, what, where your viewpoint stands, you know. It's like, so I don't sort of, I don't, you know, like I say, again, I wouldn't mind trying it. How much is this book on Amazon? I wouldn't mind to pick up this book if it was relatively cheap, but like I say, if it was, if it was really expensive, then I don't, you know, I don't want to, like, say, oh, it's $3.99, that's not bad. Actually, talking about things on the internet, one of the very first websites I can ever remember going to was thesaint.org, and watch it not be there now. And it's, I thought this was kind of cool, because it's one of those websites that's, www.saint.org, and it's one of those websites where it hasn't really ever changed since the very first time I saw it. Like, it says here copyright 1995 till 2011, but it's still being updated now. It's still got news about, I think it's got news about that new saint on there, and, it's constantly sort of talks about, like, I'm sure there was stuff about news and rumours. November 12th, 2013, it's the last thing it was updated with. But it's, I always like this website, because, like I say, if I ever sometimes, you know, I mean, like I say, just for a few seconds, I can't think what website I go to, or, you know, just, like, say, dicking around, and I just think, I wonder if some of these websites, that are some of the very first websites I ever went to, and, you know, every once in a while type 10, it's like, oh, wow, it's still there. It's kind of just almost like, reassuring, for want of a better word, because, you know, sometimes think, oh, God, you know, the internet, and, God, I'm knocking on a bit, and stuff like that. And then it's like, oh, yeah, the saint.org still there, or Dave and Jim's B-movie review is still there, or something like that. So, kind of cool that some of these little personal milestone websites for me, that's the right, completely wrong way of phrasing it, but it's what I'm going with, kind of like, are they still there? For anybody who's actually watching along with me, do you ever find Elisabeth Shue attractive? What is kind of funny about this film, because I get like this a lot when I'm watching films anyway, of like what the hell's going on, and you know, get confused really easily. But because he does change quite a lot in these films, and he has different hairstyles and mustaches and, you know, things like that, and it's just like watching 10 different films continuously. One thing I really am quite chuffed that I'd saved was it was a leaflet. It must have just been like sort of knocking around in the cinema at the time, sort of, you know, just that you could pick it up off the counter or whatever. But actually, just because I've got that in front of me, so I shouldn't forget. But one thing about this film as well, and probably one thing I do like about this movie, is I nearly always think of this when I think about this film. Is that the old ABC cinema, Canon ABC cinema, where I used to live, used to have like lobby cards in the window or little posters and things like that, and it never changed. Like in my whole lifetime, they had posters outside, a marquee with, you know, letters that would be put up manually and things like that. And I distinctly remember walking past the cinema one day when this was new, and seeing like a little poster for the film and saying, like, you know, The Saint, and, you know, and it had like a little board where you put letters on my hand, and it was like I distinctly remember that, like that, and, you know, it had like a bar, and at the time when I went to see this at the Odeon, and even though that cinema's still there, it used to have a bar just by the Odeon. You could literally be in the Odeon and go to, like, you know, buy a beer and stuff, and now that bar's gone. And so, like, I think, and again, it's like, it's something that didn't happen in the film, you know, it's like a memory connected to the movie. But I nearly always just think, did you ever find Elisabeth Shue attractive? No, but it's, I nearly always think of that when I think of this movie. So it gives that, like, sort of, oh yeah, old school cinemas, and, you know, again, it's got the, when I think that Joseph Neimat the Third, I think he worked on Escape from LA, and I saw that at the ABC as well, so I finally got this, you know, memory of seeing those movies and stuff. Actually, one person I didn't mention at the start was, he's produced by Robert Evans, and Robert Evans produced The Godfather and Love Story, and also, I must have mentioned this on other commentaries, but definitely worth checking out if you can find it. There's a really cool cartoon based on Robert Evans called Kid Notorious, and it's basically the most mental cartoon ever. It's like, he lives in, like, Beverly Hills, his next door neighbour's Slash, he's got an English butler, he's got a cat named Puss Puss. But it's kind of, the more you find out about Robert Evans, it's like, almost like a documentary. And it's like a really mental cartoon. He really does live next door to Slash. You know, he has got, like, this cat. He has, you know, it's like, oh my god, it's like, this mental cartoon is actually real. Anyway, rambling again. But this one thing I'm really glad I saved, because it's like one of those things where, again, I mean, I don't know who would want this necessarily. And again, I'll try to get a picture of all this crap and put it on the on the forum, or just a link to some kind of, you know, just the photographs, just so people can see them. If anybody who's geeky enough to want us to see this, which was a leaflet promoting the film, which was also a competition, and it says The Saint, over $170,000 worth of heavenly prizes to be won in our state-of-the-art Saint competition. And it folds out, it's got like pictures from the movie and what the film's about. To be fair, I can see why this would rub it up the wrong way. Never reveal your name, never turn your back, never surrender your heart. God, is that a tagline? Oh, yeah. But when it's got like a halo around Val Kilmer's head. And that was another thing about this film, actually. One thing I used to love about the Ian Ogilvy TV series and the Roger Moore TV series, and I think they did it in the Simon Dutton one as well, but I'm not overly familiar with that series, apart from, I think, on one episode, I'm remembering walking over... walking over this bridge in Sydney. That's the only thing I remember about the Simon Dutton TV series. Yeah, but this halo above Val Kilmer's head, I didn't think about it when I saw the movie, but one thing I liked about the original TV series was you'd get a little bit at the start and somebody would say, oh, so you're the famous Simon Templar, and he would look up and the halo would appear above him and the music would start and everything would kick in. And I never thought for a second that they would try and emulate that in this film. Like, I never thought about it. Saw this film about, you know, 10 times, and then, like, read on the internet, it's like, If you look at Val Kilmer at the end of the movie, a halo appears above his head. It's like the car reflects, like the reflection of the sun on the car windscreen makes this halo above his head. It's like, oh my god, it does. So it's like, even in this film where everything's got to be cool and like, you know, like sort of like, you know, oh, we can't do that, like that would look dead stupid. They kind of wedge that in there, like, you know, it's like, again, like these little things that got carried across. Oh, that was kind of cool. But yeah, this little leaflet thing, and these are some of the prizes that you could win. And the other day when I was looking at this, I was like, I wonder how many of these prizes are actually sort of, you know, I guess any kind of prize is worth having, even if it's just like, you know, one of these like same postcards or something. But you could win an actual C70 Volvo. And it says that this is the description for it. It says, the new Volvo C70 Coupe, the winner will receive this superb 5-cylinder, 2.3-litre turbocharged drive machine, ready for the road, complete with a 10-speaker, 60-in-watt car stereo system. And I remember for years and years and years, this next prize, even though I, you know, put off having a mobile phone for a long time, I had one then, didn't have one, and I put it off for years and years and years, I always wanted this phone. It was a Nokia 9000 communicator, and $50,000 worth of free airtime. But the actual phone, it was like this huge mobile, and it opens up and it's got a keyboard in, and I think it was about 7 years ago now, when CEX was like a second-hand slash punch shop, they had one in there, and it was like, it looked mental because it was so huge, and it was relatively expensive, so I never ended up getting it, but I wish I had now, because it was like, I'd love kind of have the same phone, even though it would look dead stupid, like just whipping up this huge mobile phone. What's the next prize? It's Bulgari Platinum Rattrapante Coniograph Sport Watch, £62,000 watch, which is, these must have put cool prizes. A holiday for two in London, Oxford, and Moscow. Oh, wow, that's all the exclusive Canali menswear. Or if the winner's a lady, a choice of specially commissioned gold necklace between this. Oh, what's that? And this is, you know, I've had this, this piece of paper for about 15 years, I think it's the first time I've ever read it. When this place is contact, use code messages on the internet. Oh, that's kind of cool. If you're not already connected to the internet. Oh, this was one thing as well. This is like one scene that I did think was pretty cool. Like, and again, it's one of those scenes where you have to take it with a massive leap of faith. But the way he got out of his room, you know, with like, you know, literally seconds to spare. This is like, again, where the car is, you know, I think it's the first time you've seen a car. But even though I hate to point out goofs, one thing I did note about this is, oh, there's the music again. But is the car number plate changes about 5 times in like about 10 seconds. And the first time I noticed it, I was like, what? Actually, I'm normally terrible at stuff like that, but this is just one of those scenes where I didn't think, you know, the number plate would change like that, because, you know, for a lot, the car doesn't really do particularly that much, but obviously, I guess, you know, different camera angles, and, you know, if they move the car out for some reason, or if one was like just a car that didn't like have an engine in it or something. But I'm sure, yeah, the number plate changes if you really pause it and go sort of frame by frame and stuff like that. But like I say, I hate sort of spotting goofs, so I almost wish I hadn't said it. But the really cool thing as well, there's a gun sound effect there. Again, these little things that crossed over from the old-fashioned TV series to this, is the like the like bullet ricocheting, just sounded like really old-fashioned, like the Saint or the Persuaders or Captain Scarlet, them kind of old-fashioned 60s, 70s sound effects. It just sounded like that. And there's a Jag there. You drove past a Jag, which, again, probably pure coincidence, probably me reading more into than actually was, but I can love that Volvo in a Jag in a Saint movie. All's right with the world then. Oh yeah, but the one cool thing about the Volvo, right at the very end of the movie, as the car's driving away, it's got the ST1 number plate, which is, again, something that got carried over from the old TV show. But again, the one thing talking about the Saint, and God, I feel like I really gained bad sense of deja vu that I've already said this on like a million commentaries. But or probably just saying it to like Tom and Stu and Curtis in the pub and stuff like that. But one thing about the Saint that always struck me as being, I'm trying to think of the right way of phrasing, but just like, why did they do that? But if you ever see Saint Toys, which you don't really see anymore, but like, if you ever see the LP 1800 Volvo as a toy, or the Jaguar XJS, they always have the Saint Man or the Saint Stick logo as the logo on the car. Well, you never ever get that in the actual movies, so I don't know why that was ever a thing. I mean, you get on the odd James Bond car, say 007, which is just as stupid, but it's literally, I don't think I've seen a Saint toy that doesn't have the Stick logo figure on the car, which is like, okay, which kind of leads me to my next bit of merchandise. Is this was years and years ago. It must have been, I don't know, 92, 93, something like that. I went to the motor show at the NEC, and they had loads of movie cars there. They had like the Aston Martin from the Living Daylights, they had the 1989 Tim Burton Batmobile, excuse me, and they had a few other cars. I think they had the Aston Martin DB5, and they had the Volvo P1800, and it's got the SD1 number plate, and just looking at a photograph of it now, and it's just thinking, wow, I saw a Saint car. But again, it's like the weird thing with the Saint, where like at the time, I don't think I was really geeking out over it. It's more sort of after the fact, so thinking, oh wow, that's pretty cool, I saw the Saint, car. Oh, there's a bloke from the Fast Show. And funny enough, I was probably rambling on about something else, but that scene where they were in that that English country pub, I'm sure there was somebody in that scene who was like, he's one of those faces that, especially if you're English, you would look at him and go, oh, who's that guy, who's that guy, who's that guy? And I'm sure he's one of those people that is like, you know, oh yeah, he's that guy from, you know, EastEnders or something. there's that giant phone. This is one of the disguises that I think is really cool, and it's actually kind of freaky. Oh, dangerously close, he actually looks like the guy's actually impersonating. It's like, that's really good makeup, and that, you know, doesn't really get enough credit, because he looks like the guy he's meant to be there. One thing as well, I don't know if I just mentioned it, I don't think I did, but these old mobile phones, and something I only found out recently, and it just was one of those mind-blowing things, but in a lot of these old mobile phones, they had antennas, and they were fake. They didn't do anything. So it was just like almost like a sort of way of reassuring people that these fancy modern mobile phones, like, you know, oh, don't worry, they work, they've got aerials. Like, that's quite funny. Again, though, it's kind of one thing, and I must have said this on the commentaries, but one kind of character I've always kind of liked in movies, and I've always kind of liked, and I was using that massive phone, I've always kind of liked in movies, in like sort of just general concept of, like, say, you look at something like, say, Get Carter in Jack Carter in Get Carter, or the Saint in The Saint, and there's a couple of characters like this where they've got no visible, kind of a little bit silly with this one, because you do see money coming in, but they kind of seem like they don't do anything, but they've got this, like, you know, Playboy sort of Bruce Wayne, well, Bruce Wayne's another one, this lifestyle of, like, sort of, you know, they don't do anything, but they've got, like, just everything at hand, like, you know, like, he isn't James Bond, but he's kind of got gadgets, and, like I say, he hasn't got Q to give him a car, but he's got, like, here's a cool car, and he's got, like, houses everywhere, and he's got, like, you know, he can just pull out, like, a credit card or cash or something. And I've always kind of found that, like, kind of, I guess most people, right, would like just to be, I'd like to be a cool guy who can get the girls in and just pull out a huge wad of money, and I guess technically he is a thief, and I guess a lot of people like Jack Carter. I mean, if you think about it for like 5 seconds, oh, you know, you're criminals, and you know that's where they get this money from. But I think there's just something about like they don't really ever meant. They don't really, you know, go, I'm a playboy thief, Simon Templar, but he's a huge wad of money. I kind of like the fact that, like, you know, that you know, there's something kind of really endearing about that. So, I guess probably why the characters, up to a point, have enjoyed as long as they have. I guess it's a kind of a appealing thing, really. What's really funny about this, though, because even though I've got another, like, you know, probably 20 minutes to do this movie, 20-25 minutes, I can't stop thinking there's something really obvious that I'm going to kick myself that I haven't mentioned. One thing as well, and again, classic, the movie fan in me had to sort of save this out of the paper, but like when I was saying, like, that newspaper cutting from the start of the video was... probably from local paper, the Sentinel, but this is, I actually have saved the full page to this, but this is the Sentinel, Wednesday, June 28th, 2006, and you don't see many cars advertised with the name of a movie or TV show in the actual listing name, and it's proper, like, old generic sort of, you know, classified section of a newspaper, and there's like Ford Escorts, Fiat Cinquecentos, BMWs, Ford KA, and Daihatsus, and Pontos, and real ordinary cars, and then you've got here Saint Car, all is one word, Volvo P1800E, 1971, very good condition, 12 months MOT, tax exempt, beautiful car, 5,500, and it's got a mobile number. What's making seem that it was printed in a newspaper? I don't know if I should say it or not. Again, like, you know, but I think it's kind of cool that, like, say that in the local area someone was selling a Saint car. You know, it's like, it's again something kind of, again, it's the thing about, there's something about this film that, like, I don't know if it's some kind of weird sort of OCD or you know, I don't know how to sort of phrase it, but like I say, there's something about this film where, you know, I don't think I can honestly say that, like, oh, you know, oh yeah, this film's amazing, it's got no faults, and it's, oh, the best film I've ever seen in my entire life. But there's something about The Saint just generally, and this movie specifically, that, like I say, if I ever see it, very, like I say, even if it's just on DVD in a shop, or, you know, on TV, I'll have to at least pick it up or watch, you know, a minute or two of it. I very rarely can just, you know, flick past it or something, so... One thing as well, because like I say, I've got the DVD literally here, and like I say, I chose to just do it off the VHS that I taped off TV. But there's a trailer on the DVD, and it's also like on YouTube, and I just sort of had a quick sort of look at it, and there's actually a little scene on the trailer where, like I say, because this. This was sort of recut, and sort of they did do reshoots and things like that. There, I just try and find it now on the actual trailer. Oh yeah, it's 33 seconds into the trailer. Shot of the Volvo with the number plate N113 or NIL3. I think it's NIII3YVA as the number plate, and it's actually raining, and I'm sure that scene isn't in the film. There's like a little deleted scene there. I don't know if there's any other scenes in the trailer there that aren't in the film. There's a shot there of Elisabeth Shue, and it's raining, and I don't think that's in the film. I don't think so. I was thinking, just when you see the bad guy, when you see the bad guys driving around, they've got this the soundtrack playing. Well, not literally, obviously, but I do think that's kind of funny, because, like I say, with the soundtrack being sort of quite a good soundtrack, I do think it's funny that just stands six that like a sore thumb to me. It's like, oh, they've got there's that song off the soundtrack, or oh, there's that song off the soundtrack. What's funny there when he's talking about his name, the people who I said I borrowed this video to when my dad didn't like it, and I said, oh, do you want to borrow it? Well, I might as well make the most of the rental kind of thing, kind of video stores, I remember those. They named their son Simon after Simon Templar, and that was another thing for years and years and years, even when they say it wasn't on TV or anything like that, because I knew that fact, and I was such a movie geek, that it was like, oh, cool, and he even had the same initial as well. Like, so his name was Simon, and his initials were ST. I thought that was kind of cool. You can hear a lot of the, just trying to figure out what that song was. It's a shame, really, that this film sort of didn't do a little bit better, else the alternate cut might have been released. I mean, especially nowadays with everything being sort of, you know, digital and on demand, I'm surprised that, you know, there isn't somewhere that I haven't got the alternate cut. This is always cool as well, though. This is like, I feel like I've mentioned this on a million commentaries, but like these scenes where they're in like Moscow, oh, it seems really cold to me. It's like, I mean, it's been relatively cold, you know, it started, you know, the end of 2013, started 2014, but it just, this seems freezing cold to me. I, you know, it's like, even if I was sitting by a roaring fireplace now, I think I'd be like, you know, it's like, geez, you know, it's pretty nippy, it looks pretty nippy there. And it's that classic thing as well, of like, this is that great sort of directing where, you know, you're like, oh my god, they're going to get caught, you know, this is that thing where, you know, it's like, obviously the heroes of the film, and you kind of know that they aren't, but at the same time, it is kind of like, you know, if this was any other film, you'd be, or if this was like real life, you know, you think, oh my god, they're going to, you know, get caught, and it is that, you know, edge of your seat kind of moment, really. It's definitely got that Firefox feel to it, it's probably why I like it so much. That music just sounds dead like Firefox. Who did the music to this? Is it like Graham Revell? It says Graham Revell, yeah. Who did the music for Daredevil also? Another one of my favourite terrible movies. Yeah, that was another thing as well, just thinking about it. This is, like I say, another one of those things where I probably would have kicked myself if I hadn't thought about it, but another thing, when I was a kid, and I probably only saw two or three, but it may as well have been 100, I saw, you see people with the Saint tattoo, and I used to always think that, like, was there some hidden meaning to that? Like, I know the Saint was a popular thing, you know, say in the 40s, 50s, 60s, but was it really that popular that you would have a tattoo of it? I you know, again, like my movie, TV moron brain that would be like, oh, you know, all the Saints. But I can't stop thinking, is there some other meaning to the Saint tattoo that I don't know about? And that's another thing as well about the Saint Stepman logo. I mean, I'm not exactly no Drew Strozen when it comes to drawing, but I think if you just get a pen and a piece of paper and try and draw that Saint man, it's a hell of a lot harder than you would think. You kind of think, oh yeah, let's draw this. I mean, I've tried to draw it on, I think, on this tape and on a different tape. I mean, I taped some Saint stuff off the TV. And you think, oh, let's have a quick go at drawing the Saint Stickman. And it's like, it's deceptively difficult. Actually, that's one thing, talking about the Saint and sort of, you know, different things and things, different sort of formats and different media. But one thing that I absolutely loved, just one of those genius, it was genius anyway, but using the Saint music was just, it just was over the edge to me, was in I think it's the first series of Alan Partridge. There's one episode where Alan Partridge takes Lynn to her mother's mother's grave for put some flowers, and he says he's got, I think it must be a never say Alan again, because I think he's watching the James Bond movies, and he says to her, oh, you've got 10 minutes, and he listens to the Return of the Saint theme dad loud in his car while she's at this grave. It's just like, no matter what music they use there would have been like, you know, just genius. But it was like, I mean, just using that music to me was brilliant. There's also a Jeff Love version of the Return of the Saint theme, which to me is like, you know, I probably mentioned on other things, and I've definitely mentioned on the forum, but one person I really got a soft spot for the albums for is Jeff Love and his orchestra. Used to cover versions of like classic movie themes and themes of the day, and popular TV show themes and movie themes, and he did one for Return of the Saint. I only found out about it about 2 or 3 years ago. I was like, oh my god, he did Return of the Saint. Then we found Elisabeth Shue attractive. That's actually pretty brutal. Again, this is one of those scenes where you know really deep down that, you know, nine times out, especially, you know, in this bizarro alternate cut of it, you know they're not going to get caught, but at the same time it's like, oh my god, they're going to get caught. What is kind of funny about this though as well, and even though it's incredibly, you know, it's a little bit like, you know, the romantic love interest is always a little bit sometimes seem forced in a movie, but it's kind of a good sort of, again, you know, I could see again when we draw people the wrong way, this woman drops them right in it, doesn't she? But like the way in the TV show, it was kind of cool that he would literally go to some far-flung place in the middle of nowhere, and they would always go, oh, the famous Simon Templar, and the music with stars and all that, which is cool. But it's kind of cool though, in a way, that even in this, even he doesn't know who he is. Or, you know, he's struggling to come to terms with, you know, oh, I'm this guy that's got all these, you know, all these split personalities and all these, I play characters and things like that. So there's something kind of endearing about that, really, that, like, you know, it's like, it is like the TV show, but completely flipped. I'm sure, like I say, that's gonna. I just don't know what to say. Simon Templar, giant spider. I'm sure I read something about that. what's with the Saint novelization? Saints is the title of a mystery novel by Paul Barra, published by Pocket Books in 1997, based upon the screenplay of The Saint, which in turn is loosely based on the character Simon Templar. Brilliant. It was the first Saint story to be published since Tartrus's death in 93. It's actually been followed by a different novel, followed by, in 1997 too. There hasn't been a Saint novel since 1997. Oh, there's the watch that you could win. You could win just the prop from the movie. It's actually kind of cool in a way that there's loads of stuff in the film that you could actually just win. Even the car. And that's something about this film that I did kind of like I was saying earlier on, that like, if you split this up into like 25-minute segments, which is actually kind of a cool idea, I might try and attempt, you know, maybe not edit it, but just, you know, see where the 25-minute sections would end. But, like, here, how it's just flying along, like, on the one minute, like, oh, I'm in this building, I'm underground in Moscow, oh, you know, and it's just like there, he's just pulled out some kind of gadget, like, say, no real explanation, nobody's giving this gadget, he hasn't, like, you know, he hasn't said, oh, I make gadgets, or, you know, or he's got some scientist guy helping him, just like, no, I've got, like, this little mini blowtorch, like, you know, I kind of, like, say, found that always so endearing. I like to think that Volvo was just jam-packed of, like, guns and, you know, like, computer things and, you know, a cool suit and a bottle of booze. Kind of reminds me of that Futurama joke, which I think, weirdly enough, Futurama's on after this tape. It reminds me of that Futurama joke where Fry's like in these sewers and he said this is the way out, and it's like this little tiny pipe to go through, but in the area and it's like locked. And again, this is a great scene, and like, you know, normally in films you can just like, you know, but I think this is a kind of genuinely like, you know, I'm not like, oh my, you know, I don't like gripping the edge of my seat and my knuckles are going white, but at the same, that said, I mean, it's like they're in some tunnel, a load of water's coming. They're kind of basically dead, you know. It's like, oh my god, they're dead. Like, you know, it's like. Also, and this was an interesting thing as well, that with sort of embassies that, like, especially the LOCH say something like Argo or something like that, but, like, such a great, such an interesting concept that, like, you know, you can just sort of, there is an embassy for every country in every country, and sort of, you know, if you are in sort of, if you are a citizen of that country, you can just go in that embassy, and, you know, the, you know, it's like, because I have seen too many movies, and think, do embassies really exist? And then you're like in London, they're like, they're everywhere. I like that, their focus point, that was cool. Another thing as well, I think it's like the last of the things that have been dug out for, like, sort of, sort of say, oh, this is some Saint stuff I've got. Weird, I've got a model of the Saint car as well, which, I guess I would have just gone, oh, it's the Saint car, so it's not that, not that good. Well, it's the Jaguar XJS one, so it's pretty cool. But one thing, I only ever got one issue of it, because, I've already brought, like, every single one of the James Bond car vehicle collection, and it was, 120 issues for about 7 years, and it cost me and my dad about £1,000. And it won't be caught into some magazine buying marathon again, unless it's Empire or Mad Magazine. But one thing I got that was, you know, especially just a one off was, and I'd love to know if it's still going, it's the Saint Complete DVD Collection magazine. That's where we sell it on eBay. Yeah, someone's selling a couple of shoes here. Oh, all look like they've never been opened. but this is it was the Saint Complete DVD collection. It was I think they were trying to put all the Roger Moore episodes of the Saint into, like, some, like, you know, collectible magazine with a free DVD with two episodes stuck onto the front on one DVD as the Saint music again. That's, I've just thought of a great Saint drinking game. There are some of you that little Saint riff that you have a drink, but it was like saying, well, probably why I didn't get it was A, you know, if I did want the sort of the Saint thing, I'd probably just buy the box set or something, you know, save, by, let's say, hundreds of issues of this magazine. But it's got, like, a little survey here. Giving away the best of the Saint volumes 1 and 2. This is always brilliant, though, as well. Like, over the years, these magazines have been repeated so many times. Not this particular one, but, like, it's like in issue 3 or something, you get a free binder. Like, what are the free gifts here? Part 2, you get a free binder. Part 3, you get free Saint prints. Then a free case. Oh, then a free. Oh, this is if you subscribe, I think. Don't get me wrong, it would have been one of those things. It would have been really awesome to sort of, to, you know, to get them all if you just got, like, money burn or something like that. But one thing I've read that was kind of cool, I think even Val Kilmer did it as well, is that anybody who's played the Saint was sort of like a member of, like, you know, the honorary sort of president of the Saint sort of fan club. I think, I'm sure, Roger Moore, Ian Ogilvy, Simon Dutton and Val Kilmer have all done that. Well, that was one thing as well at the start that I thought was quite good. The way it said, just like I said, Moscow tomorrow. Like, so it's like, it's almost like if you just discount all the old kind of technology, it's kind of like it hasn't, you know, sort of, it in a way, it's like it's not aged in terms of year, because it just says, like, you know, like it's happening right now. And the thing is, well, if you type in the Saint 1997 on YouTube, I think, you might have taped Saint VHS, I think. but somebody's captured the Saint, the intro to the Saint VHS of like the there was a competition on there. I've got to give away a ton of stuff, and it's like one of those things that's like, again, really endearing. It's just like, oh my god, it's so old fashioned looking, even though it's, you know, not that old, right? It's old enough, I guess. He's one of those guys as well, the guy that plays the main bad guy. I've seen him in a lot of different things over the years, and he's always one of them people where I'm like, where do I know that guy from? Where do I know that guy from? Where do I know that guy from? It's like, oh yeah, he's a bad guy at the Saints. It's like, literally, it's just like that, because like I say, there's like about 10 films that I have seen a lot like this, and Daredevil and Firefox and that, and there's certain actors that just pop up all over the place, and they're all like, oh yeah, it's that guy. I thought this was kind of like, you know, again, I guess this is one of those, depending on how sort of flexible you are with, like, you know, suspension of disbelief, the, like, there was just dressed like an old cleaning woman, like, I imagine that just rubbing you up the wrong way. But again, I kind of like about this film that the way it's so sort of really serious and dead stupid all at the same time. It's like, you know, it's one of the few films where, I'm going to say, the comic relief necessarily works, but I do. You know, normally if a film is kind of ping-pongs back and forth like that, it can normally a bit sort of hit and miss, but I do think it kind of works. It's amazing to go, oh yeah, she's coming, she's this great scientist, she's coming up with, like, you know, this theory for, like, free energy, and then it's like, here's Val Kilmer dressed like a cleaning woman. It's like, okay. You know, it is amazing how much I will let slide for this film. Like there, though, he's got, like say, you know, I do like, again, I think the thing with this character was so cool is, like, again, he had these disguises. It's like, yeah, I'm in Moscow, I'm in some random place, yeah, I've got all my disguises still. I kind of like that, like, you know, it's like literally 5 minutes ago, he was underground in some sewer, literally giving away his watch so he could get some information. And then, like, you know, within, like, you know, 20 minutes later, you know, not even 20 minutes screen time, but, you know, just say for argument's sake, it was 20 minutes, half an hour later, he's got into the American embassy in a completely, in a disguise. It's like, okay, that's cool to me. Kind of like as well though that three miracles thing there, it kind of just like, and that's just me being a bit off soap, but I just kind of like how it's just something that's like just proper shoehorned in right at the last minute. I don't think it was mentioned at any other time, but this is one of these things about this film as well, when I was saying that, where it kind of, you know, got good memories attached to it of, like, you know, renting it or seeing the poster for it at the cinema or getting seats at the cinema or, you know, things like that. But like, there's something about the technology in this film where kind of almost bridges the gap for me, like, where I remember, like, say, I don't know, having like a little portable black and white TV in my bedroom, or, you know, people across the street like having, you know, old fashioned dial telephone or something, or, like, say, just going to cinema with a marquee and stuff like that. And then at the same time, you know, you're looking at this and they're all using like laptops and mobile phones and the internet and things like that, and it's just like that perfect, like, sort of, you know, borderline passing the baton sort of thing of, like, you know, in the mid 90s, you probably could still, you know, you go in somebody's house and they'd have a dial phone, you wouldn't be that surprised that he's just received a fax. I mean, you know, I think last time, you know, just flukily the week I accidentally dialed a fax number by accident, so I was like, oh, faxes still exist, like, you know, and that's coming from me. That's one thing I do like about this, though, that this version taped off TV is, like, the subtitles are actually embedded into the print. I do really like that, like, you know, it's not like, say, if I put this DVD on, that, like, you know, they'd probably been generated by the actual machine, and, you know, it'd be like, you know, dead computery. Something about this, like I say, the few scenes here, there's like the scene just makes me think of, like, you know, seeing it on TV. Like, I just imagine watching it, like, on TV late at night. I don't know what it is about that scene, like, you know, just probably because I did watch it on TV late at night. I do quite like about Val Kilmer, though, as well, that he does seem like he's got a pretty good sense of humour, because, like, you know, it's like, a lot of times, you know, I've heard a few people say, you know, things about Val Kilmer one way or the other, but to me, he does seem like, you know, like I say, he's been Batman, he's been the Saint, and he was in, like, Life Too Short recently with, like, Warwick Davis, where he was talking about, like, you know, doing, like, a sequel to Willow, and, like, you know, he was having, like, loads of people just take the mick out of him for, like, you know, nobody could remember him for being Batman, you know, and it's just like, you know, and again, it's that thing of, like, you know, like, again, this film's got this reputation for being one thing, and, like, you know, Val Kilmer, I don't know why Val Kilmer's got this reputation, that, you know, for sort of, you know, being something where I think, like, you know, it's like, like I say, I'm classed myself as a huge Val Kilmer fan, but I think he's done some things that are, actually, I haven't said that, he was Batman, he's the Saint, and how can I forget, he's the voice of Kit in the new Knight Rider. Actually, that's pretty strong in terms of, you know, if I'm going to be a fan of something. I mean, if you're Batman, the Saint, and Kit, it's about three miracles. I mean, that's not bad going, actually, is it really? Again, he's just got, like, another disguise, another uniform, but I can sort of see how that would sort of annoy people, like, oh, that's stupid, but to me, that's so sort of, it's like, he's got another uniform on, it's like, brilliant, it's like, you know, it's like, and it's like, immaculate as well, like, you know, perfectly, like, you know, no, you know, it's not dirty or anything, it's like, you know, where was it, like, and it's like, hanging up with a coat hanger or something somewhere. Well, when they're talking about, like, you know, like, I feel like that scene a few scenes ago where I feel like, God, I just picture that watching that late at night on, like, a portable TV or something. But, like, now, God, I just feel like I should have a Chinese takeaway with me or something. I just feel like, you know, I should have just nipped in the Chinese, get a Singapore chow mein, and I should be tucking into that, watching this. That's a perfect night in for me, watching this film, Chinese takeaway sorted, and be a option, you know. Kind of like as well about this film that, like, where would they have gone with this movie if it had been successful? It had been a sequel, because doesn't she come up with like free energy? And I know it's a bit of like I say, it is just like almost like the money in Psycho or the Lost Ark and Raised Lost Ark. It's not the, you know, the movie is the adventure around that thing, but if in the sequel, like, oh, the world's got free energy, like, you know, I don't know what difference that would make necessarily, but it's just been like, would have been an interesting thing to try and write around, or would they have just forgot it? It is interesting as well, talking about like how sort of culture changes and things like that, but the way when you think that, like, you know, you watch something like Firefox or Red Heat, and they try to do a crafty shot of Red Square, and, you know, just be, I think even in Firefox, I think it's like blue screen or something like that, or, you know, no pun intended, because a lot of blue light there, but you think, like, God, how times changed there, they're just filming in Red Square, you know, it's like, wow. I hope that pilot does show up though, like, say, even just like a download or something like that, because, like, say, I mean, I'm not sort of heartbroken that it's not been turned into a series, that new 2013, 2014 pilot, but that said, I mean, you know, it's like, it'd be nice to see it, and Ian Ogilvy's in it as well. I mean, I know that works, it's got Roger Moore and Ian Ogilvy in it, it's like, okay, three Saints, I assume they're not playing the Saint room, so, interesting, Oh, it's a miracle. That's actually kind of cool. I think that what is kind of interesting though, I can actually see in some ways though that, like, you know, don't think about it till they actually sort of vocalise it, or think about it as you're watching it, but, like, I can kind of see in some ways why a lot of people wouldn't go with this film in a way that sense that, like, you know, you've got to, you know, like, say, everything from, like, you know, Tim Burton's Batman onwards, you know, it has to be, you know, everything has to be dead cool and stuff like that. That's probably what I think about it. He's watching black and white TV there. But yeah, that scene there, that's pretty, you know, it's pretty sort of romantic, for want of a better word. Music again. This is one of the few films, though, if the, you know, like, say, that has sort of incorporated the old theme into the new sort of version of it. I mean, I know sort of the new Star Trek uses the old music and stuff, but actually using it as a through into the actual film, you know, in different scenes, like sort of, you know, linking scenes together and things like that. What was really funny though, because that Inspector Teal character, I've got to admit though that, like, I'm such a moron sometimes when it comes to things like that, because, like I say, watching The Saints as a kid, and that Inspector Teal, I didn't even know he was like a reoccurring character. It was just like, He's like, oh, okay, yeah. It's like, only since this movie, you know, people say, oh, this movie's this or that. It's only since this movie that I watch Old Saints and go, oh, yeah, Inspector Teal. Oh, yeah, okay. It's like, I never knew who he was. I think that this is one thing about this film that, well, I would have thought was in this film's favour, and I think it even says it on the saint.org at the bottom of the pages, where it says something like, was it on... Oh, that was another thing, yeah, there was a graphic novel coming July 2012, that's one insane thing I wouldn't mind. Yeah, but it says something like, watch out for the sign of the saint, it will be back, but this is in this where, I was going to say, it took a long while for it to actually come into this film, but she passes him the brooch of, like, the saint logo. That's one thing about this film. I thought, oh, any other versions of the saint or any other novelizations or any books of the saint had as a cool thing was this saint logo, that if you got it big enough again, you can literally just put that somewhere. It's like, oh yeah, the saint, you know, it like literally is like a stick man drawing. You know, it's like, I thought that'd be kind of cool to have like on bus stops or something like that, or, you know, especially nowadays, just, you know, sort of, you know, a different place up the corner on a screen somewhere or something. Tell me if I find Elisabeth Shue attractive. What was actually quite funny, actually, to make like videos and stuff. I put an old VHS on the other day, and it was like just loads of random stuff that I recorded, and one of them was Roger Moore on the Paul O'Grady show, and it must have been 4 or 5 years ago, and he was saying, oh, we're working on like a new version of the saint and things like that, and we talked about Paul O'Grady said, oh, I hope it's not like that Avengers, and I was thinking, you know, it's like, you know, talking about something with Sean Connery, and I thought Roger Moore was quite diplomatic about it. He was like, you know, saying, oh, maybe, you know, didn't 100% work and that, which is interesting, though, just thinking that, like, you know, like Sean Connery was in that, you know, the Avengers movie, and then, you know, you've got like this new version of the saint that's come out, you know, and it's like, I know, just kind of interesting, you know, that Avengers movie is, you know, I guess it's as old as this, really, but it seemed funny that, you know, thinking, oh yeah, Sean Connery, God, he doesn't really act anymore, you know, it's like, then they actually sort of, I think I saw somebody on selling them on eBay once. That was called Culture Brooch. what is the male version of that? It seems like it's a pen. But yeah, I think somebody was selling them on eBay, made from the proper mould and everything. I don't think I've ever even seen the sort of deleted scenes of like, where, like, you know, she sort of died and stuff in the original cut. It'd be interesting to see sort of where that would have happened years ago. Oh, well, it would have happened in the original version, I should say. I'm not thinking that saint man on that pin is the wrong way around. I don't really even know what that means. Although it's the same on that website, I always associate him with him sort of going the opposite way. Although on the CD cover he's sort of got his hand pointing to the left. Uh, okay. Not, there's nothing wrong with that. What is really funny though, that sort of, if, like, say, if this film was just on TV or whatever, it's kind of funny though that, like, looking at it from why this might have sort of annoyed people, kind of I can sort of see if you were just like a bloke who's like, I'm on me, this is like, you know, probably it's like, you know, it's like, oh jeez, you know, it's a bit lovey-dovey again, for once, for a better phrase. I remember actually, just funnily enough, because that's the proper orbital sort of single version of it, and I remember actually, I was still living at my parents', I think, when this film came out, and I'd got the CD single of the orbital version of the Saint theme. I remember my mum's friend was around, and when that opening riff come on, she was like, oh, the Saint! And I was like, oh yeah, you know, it was like, again, it was like that thing, though, they carried all this stuff across. I mean, it's a shame, really, when they did throw as much of a bone as they did to, you know, old school Saint fans, and, you know, again, people still weren't, and, you know, it was like, you know, so it's like, not that bitter or anything that it didn't, you know, spawn a sequel or anything. What's really funny, because, like I say, this scene, it's like, that's really such, it's kind of funny to me. That Alex from that British guy, who was that, who, the... That's great though as well, there's somebody with the exact same haircut who he just happened to be chasing, oh yeah. That Peugeot in front of him there. Ah, the car owns the same thing, brilliant. ST1 on the number plate, and it's like a prequel in a way. There, just drives off and boom, is the Saint. This is I think you can notice it more on the Roger Moore's voice there on the radio. For anybody who's still with us, there's the Saint logo above him, and I say that's almost a perfect way of ending it for me. That's there's the car, and there's the end of the movie, and a bit of the old Duran Duran, tell you what, it's all coming up Millhouse, isn't it? What's really funny about this though, because I think these credits on this though, they always look speeded up, and because this version taped off TV, I always think, oh, they've speeded up the credits, oh god, you can really tell they've speeded up the credits, but oh no, they're talking over him now, what's he saying? Charlton Heston in 2 minute warning, what's that? Yeah, but the credits always look speeded up on this version taped off TV. But I'm sure on the DVD they look the same speed, so it's like, I don't know why the credits are so speeded up, it's probably just one of those things, but yeah, thanks for listening everybody, and hope I did a good defence of it. Could be a series, me defending different films. I think I just saw Sega then, Simon Templar C70 by Kodak, by Volvo, just saw the words Kodak as well. Thanks for listening everybody, and see you next time, see you later.